Hey, welcome to the sixth round. We are up against a guy who, like, I googled him and turns out he's played some sneak show, so I'm like, oh, please not. And then he types this in the chat. Apparently it's like duplicated or triplicated. And he was like, oh, I had to face elves at some point, huh? And I'm like, yeah, whatever, dude. You're playing a deck that's probably super good against elves. So I'm like, yeah, this hand isn't bad. And once again, it has some plan against Sneak Show. So let's just keep this and see where it goes. Turns out I was wrong. Yeah, that happens sometimes. Pretty sure I'm gonna go for Dryad Arbor here because I need the Nettle Sentinel for the Glimpse Chain. And especially with the Cradle, the Dryad Arbor is worth so much more. Opponent now goes for Carbotherapy, naked, on. What's it called? I've cast this spell a couple of times, Glimpse of Nature. Which is unfortunate because now we have to just switch into Beatdown mode. And at this point, I'm like, okay, interesting. He's probably on Storm at Nauseam Tendrils, which, by the way, needs a better name. But I guess at this point it's already like in the community that it's like A and T aren't, even though a couple of people have actually made like a case to rename it to just Storm, because we still got like Tess, the Epic Storm, and this deck basically is what Storm is about these days. We don't really do these other weird Storm decks anymore, like Cobalt Storm or whatever. It's this is Storm, then there's another Storm deck which is called Tess or the Epic Storm. So yeah. If it was up to me, we would just call this deck Storm. I think that's actually a really reasonable thing to do. So, thinking that this is Storm and having nothing to spend my mana on next turn, and even if I draw something, I would want the Cradle anyway, or use the Cradle anyway, I'm untapping my Dryad Arbor, giving up my land drop just to get in for one more point of damage, because sometimes that can make a difference. Even though you should probably do the math, if I drew Senate, say I had this in play, one, then play 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Yeah, so if I drew Senate, I couldn't cast it for Behemoth anyway. But if I drew actual Behemoth, it would have been better to have the Bayou in play. So it's, yeah, that's basically a trade-off. If you draw Behemoth, you can't cast it next turn. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Oh, could I even cast it? Oh yeah, because land would be in play, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And use this 8, yeah, that's the thing. So yeah, basically that's a trade-off. Getting one more point of damage or not being able to cast Behemoth on the next turn if you drew it. I think I'd rather have the point of damage here. Opponent goes for Ponder of Volcanic Island. Once again, still feels like it's Storm. All I want to draw is Natural Order here. Getting a second Dryad Arbor, and we actually do draw the Behemoth. I don't even. Now I remember why I remembered that it actually makes a difference. So, yeah, I'm pretty sure we can cast the Behemoth here. So we just get him for 5. And get ready to kill him on the next turn with Behemoth. So I'm like, oh fuck, now he's tapping mana. Oh, that can't be good. What? Wild Smash of the Fierce. Yeah. So if you don't know what this guy does, the first spell you play every turn deals damage to the opponent equal to the converted mana cost of that spell. The turn you play it, and if you like afterwards protect it with Force of Will on the same turn, it doesn't deal damage because this guy would be the first turn. But from then on out, the way this deck works, and he's playing the more controllish version of the deck, he's not playing the Delver aggro version. He just plays a couple of big expensive spells like Dev spells. He even plays like, or at least this deck usually plays also stuff like Logic Knot, where you Delve a couple of cards in your graveyard away to counter something. So if you had like 20 cards in your graveyard, you could like delve for 20 and kill the opponent. It would be like pretty weird. But fortunately for us, we just get the Behemoth in there. Cast the free Quirion Rain, the free Wild Symbiote. And then attack with our carrier. First game goes to us, and I'm actually quite thankful that the opponent revealed this card because I would have bought it in a super awkward way had I not seen that. Like, I guess he has to play it because he can't know about this, and we haven't done anything with our mana on the turn before, so it makes sense for us to sit on AR, but like, top typing skills, Elves has them. So, let's head for the second game. In the second game, how did I sideboard? So I brought in all Abrupt Decays, which makes sense because the deck is, I don't want to say super dependent, but quite dependent on getting his Wild Smasher online. And I also took out these for chokes. So basically I brought in, and I took, oh yeah, that makes sense. Okay. So I took out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 cards. I brought in 3 decays, 2 chokes, and 2 chemotherapies. Chemotherapy makes sense. Like, it's always a good card when your opponent plays something more control-ishy, and especially if he plays lots of expensive spells. Because expensive spells are sometimes easier to read, and you also have like a bigger window where you can actually hit them. So, and also not like being sure what I'm about to face, I think I'd rather have some discard. So that's what I went with. If the opponent played the more beatdown heavy version, I'm pretty sure I wouldn't play this card. This end is great. Like, all it needs is a second land or Krillin Ranger once again, and it would be golden. Opponent keeps 7. Goes for basic island, which is weird, but okay. And it's weird because, like, not because of him, but because I don't know what to make of it. Why would you get basic island there? That actually makes me feel a bit nervous. Why would you not get a dual land there? I get a forest even though I drew a black source, because this island actually really threw me off, and I also don't see needing the Bayou anytime soon anyway. Because I thought I had a Deathrite Shaman up, but turns out Submerge, the most efficient, best sideboard card in the history of Legacy, it gets me. It's so annoying because this is almost like, since we missed the land, yeah, it's actually, yeah, it's like a time walk. Since we missed the land drop, it's pretty much a time walk. It's a zero mana explorer. I guess Petrocini would have liked that. Fortunately for us, the opponent, well, he fetched. So I was about to say he didn't find a red source, but he could have found a red source if he really wanted, but apparently he didn't want to. He values his basics quite highly. Yeah, okay. I'm playing the Wildwood Symbiote, and I think I should play the Nelson Sentinel afterwards. Oh, I have 2 death rites. Oh yeah, that makes sense. Okay, because I really want to make sure that I get to untap with the Deathrite Shaman next turn. Like, that's kind of double protection for Deathrite. And that way we also get to have better glimpses next turn. The downside is, if he Chemotherapies me here, I'm in trouble, but I don't... Actually, he could have Chemotherapy. I think that deck sometimes plays that. Or would he? No, he wouldn't play Chemotherapy in a deck full of expensive creatures and high-value creatures like Wild Smasher. Anyway, we get Pyrokinesist or whatever, but basically it's actually a 2-for-1 for us, even though it puts us a bit behind tempo-wise. Because we bounce the Deathrite Shaman. And then we still get to untap the Deathrite Shaman, which is pretty cool, unless he has another removal spell for that as well. What did he pitch, by the way? He pitched Lightning Bolt. Weird. Because technically, had you fetched a red source on the last turn, you could have just gone like Lightning Bolt the Wildwood Symbiote, but maybe he was thinking then he would never use the Pyrokinesis again, and this way he can at least like bounce the Deathrite Shaman for a turn. But in a deck with Brainstorm, even if you think you can't cast a Pyrokinesis again, you might as well just keep it around. So yeah. I'm playing the Glimpse here, because I really, like, the only way I can actually see me losing this game is if I keep struggling on mana, because my mana really isn't very good at this point. It's super dependent on Heritage Druid getting there. Okay, there's Blood Moon. Okay, this is weird. Okay, I guess it's Wild Smasher Blood Moon. So be it. On our turn, I could just get the Black Sword, the Black Mana, and take out the Blood Moon. So I'll be able to probably just draw a card. I think that's what you want to do. Oh no, I can't because there's no land in the graveyard. So I just play Nettle Sentinel and set up for a really good glimpse on the following turn. Opponent 5 mana. He could hardcast Force of Will, but I think that wouldn't even be too bad for us, because having this kind of hand, we can actually get to hardcast Crowd of Behemoth pretty quickly, as long as Heritage Druid gets to survive. And if he fights our Glimpse, yeah, that's okay. We have a pretty decent beatdown going on at this point. That's the thing about elves, like, if the opponent is passive and doesn't, like, produce any virtual card advantage in the form of, like, a blocker that can actually, like, block Nettle Sentinel or, like, even like just like these guys, you can just like grind it out damage wise, not even card advantage wise. He goes for hardcast Force of Will, I'm like, sure. And I think I might actually just attack here. Yeah, okay. Now I'm just so happy when my thoughts actually like collide in a way. Like, you could always play the Heritage Druid here and then cast these two and then keep going. The thing is, The only way I see myself losing at this point is mass removal. And if he does have mass removal, it's so much better to have those guys in hand. Whereas if I played all of this and he goes Toxic Deluge and I'm like, I have this 8 drop and 2 lands, that's horrible. So just be aware of what you're doing. And I even actively took out the Lightning Bolt so he can't Snapcaster Mage it. It's always awkward when you're like at the opponent's end of turn, you want to activate your Deathrite Gem, but you know if he has a Snapcaster Mage, he can do it in response. So you're not doing it in the first place. So in situations like that, it's better to like proactively use the Deathrite Gem when the opponent is tapped out on your turn. What is he doing? Oh, he gets the Wild Smasher. But shouldn't be too much of a problem. Wild Smasher and Pyromancer. Okay, okay. Okay, so at this point I was thinking, okay, maybe since he's out of cards and he doesn't know what the top card is, I should probably just set up for Krat Oath next turn. But having drawn the Nissa, I think I can do both. I think I should be able to get Nissa. It depends on what I draw of the Visionaries here. I guess I could draw Cradle. Huh. I was waiting for me to draw Cradle, but turns out I didn't. So, am I gonna hardcast Nissa here? I think it makes sense. I can still do it. 1, 2, 3, 1, 3, 4. Yes. Even if I don't draw anything of this guy. So, okay, so good for 3. Yeah, even if I hadn't drawn this land, I could have still cast Nissa afterwards. Which is the important part, because, like, as I mentioned, it's super unlikely for him to top deck mass removal, but if he did, it's good to have Nissa in play. Even though, can this guy shoot? Opponent chosen at random. Is damage equal to that? Yeah, damage. Okay, so he can actually. If he found some 5 mana mass removal spell, he could have. Or 6 mana mass removal spell, he could even kill Nissa that way, but that would be weird. So it's super unlikely. And I just get Nissa out and attack him for 5. He goes down to 4, and next turn he's just dead to Deathrite Gem, and yeah. He's like, okay, there's nothing I can do, you take it. So, we advance to 5-1 after starting out with a loss in the Legacy Challenge. And next round, well, technically we would have had our win and in, but fortunately for me, I was paired down like crazy. Like, I think I was in 5th place. Okay, so spoiler alert, our opponent in the next round scoops because he's in 17th place before the last round. And I think we were in 5th place. 4th place? 5th place? Anyway, we needed to win because you can't draw and like a loss would have put us out of top 8. And the opponent was in 17th place. He was just playing for top 16. So I don't know how that works. And it was always nice that I actually played against a friend of mine. So like he realized what was going on before I did. So I went away and then I came back and I'm like, oh, Julian23 wins the game. I'm like, sure. I was just making some spaghetti, whatever. So yeah, that's what happens in the next round. So we are actually top 8. So see you in the quarterfinals.